We're going to continue our series of messages entitled Hashtag HBC Live Sent, Haven Baptist Church Live Sent. And we're talking today about Live Sent as ambassadors of Christ. And we gave you some hashtags to go along with this. Hashtag sent to share. We've been sent as His ambassadors to share His word. Sent to care, share His love. Sent to bless, to be a blessing to others. Christians have been sent out into the everyday paths of life to bring the knowledge and the presence of Jesus to our world. We've been sent to bring the knowledge and the presence of Jesus into our world. Last week we learned that we're sent to be the fragrance or the aroma of Christ, to bring an awareness of His presence. Today, we're going to learn, as we mentioned, that we are sent to be His ambassadors, the ambassadors of Christ. And the Bible says, we're going to read that God is pleading to this world through us. Through us. Sometimes, you know, I do pray for God to speak to people, and He has to, but you know, I know the word, and God tells me that I'm going to speak to them through you. I'm going to plead through you to them. He's going to plead through you. That's what it says. And His plea is to be reconciled to God. That men would be reconciled to God. That people would be reconciled to God. So over the next 2 weeks, we're going to see some important truths about our role as Christian ambassadors in this world and what it means to live sent. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, beginning in verse number 12. For we do not commend ourselves again to you, but give you opportunity to boast on our behalf, that you may have an answer for those who boast in appearance and not in heart. For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God, or if we are of sound mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ compels us, because we judge thus, that if one died for all, then all died. And he died for all, that those who live should live no longer for themselves, but for Him who died for them and rose again. Therefore, from now on we regard no one according to the flesh, even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know Him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Hallelujah. Verse 18, now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to Himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to Himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word or the message of reconciliation. Now then, here it is, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. There may be somebody in your life that God's pleading with you to be reconciled, and God's using them. That's the ambassador. Verse 21, for He made Him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in Him. Let's pray together. Lord, we love You. We thank You for Your word. And Father, just speak to us today. We just pray You'll be honored and glorified in everything that's said and everything that's done, in our response to the word, in our hearing of the word, in our believing of the word. Today, Father, if there's one here that's never been reconciled to You, today would be the day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, we're talking about living sent. What does that mean? What does that little two-word phrase mean, live sent? Well, you've seen it last week, but here it is again. To live sent means to live with priority and purpose for the gospel. It means that living for Christ and for the gospel becomes the priority of my life. Therefore, it affects the purpose of how I live as a Christian. It affects the purpose. Everything I do is related to this priority of being an ambassador, this priority of being the aroma of Christ for God's purposes. And in this passage, Paul uses the metaphor, the illustration of an ambassador. What is an ambassador? Well, an ambassador is an official envoy, the highest ranking diplomat who represents a state and usually represents a state to another sovereign state or another international organization. They often are the resident representative of their government in that foreign land. Now think about that when you think about what it means to be a Christian. You know, as an ambassador, the ambassador's priority and purpose is to represent their king or their country. Actually, when you read the New Testament, the ambassadors didn't represent countries as much. They didn't go over there and set up like a United States embassy and have the United States flag. You know who they represented? They represented the king. The person who sent them was the king. It wasn't about the country. It was about you go and tell them what I want and what I need. You represent me. Think about that as a Christian. Listen, you represent the king. You represent the King of Kings. You're his ambassador. Listen, you ought to be a witness and you ought to tell people about Haven Baptist Church. But I'm going to tell you, you're not a Baptist ambassador. You're not a Haven ambassador. You're a King's ambassador. Jesus is the King. Now, you also are an ambassador in a foreign land. What do you mean? I've always lived in America. I know. But you know what happened when you got saved? The Bible says your citizenship now is in heaven. This place isn't your home anymore. When you got saved, the Bible says your citizenship, Philippians chapter 3, is in heaven, and immediately you became a foreigner in this land. You ever feel like this place is strange to you and it's getting stranger? I want to tell you, the closer you get to Jesus, the stranger this world will get. And you're now an ambassador. You're in a foreign land and you represent your king in a foreign land. This is what we are. We're his witnesses. We're his salt and light. We're his fragrance. We're his aroma. This isn't our home. We've got to stop living like this is our home. Some of us live like this is all there is, and we've just put all our roots down here. We've just invested everything in the here and now. We're just living for this. This is it. But I'm going to tell you something. This is going to end, and you're going to have to go be with him, and I'm going to get to go be with him. And I want to go and hear him say, well done, good and faithful servant. Thank you for being my ambassador. And you can't live like this is all there is and be an ambassador. You got to live for his interest. That's what it means to be an ambassador. You're representing someone else's interest. That's why you have a priority and purpose for the gospel. But I want to talk to you today about our motivation as ambassadors. What would motivate Paul to go through all he went through to live as Christ's ambassador? And what is going to motivate us? That's a big question, isn't it? Pastors, I read all kinds of books, all kinds of articles, all kinds of emails. Pastors are wondering, what's going to motivate us? Well, and some are trying to come up with new ways. Listen, I don't need any new ways. Man, we got the way right here. The way that God's motivated people all along is right here in the book. What is going to motivate us to be his ambassadors? Well, there's one today. There's plenty, but this is a major one. It's right here in the text I want to show you. Here it is, the love of Christ. The love of Christ is going to have to motivate us to be his ambassadors. Look at verse 14. For the love of Christ compels us. Now I want to give you the setting. Remember last week I told you 2 Corinthians, Paul is dealing with the fact that he had some problems with people in the church, or the people in the church had some problems with him. They started questioning his authority. They started questioning his apostleship. They started questioning his integrity. But know what you read here in this chapter? Some of them were questioning his sanity. Right here, look. Look what it says. So back up in verse 12. For we do not commend ourselves again to you, but give you opportunity to boast on our behalf. What he's saying is, there's some people that have been putting us down and saying that we're not real apostles. And he said, I'm not going to address it. You know what we are. Why don't you address it? Why don't you tell them that we're the real deal? Why do I have to write back and defend myself? Why don't you do it? And one of the things that those people were doing was they were saying Paul's insane. How do we know that? Look at verse 13. For if we are beside ourselves. That was a little phrase they were using about Paul. It means to be an insane fanatic. Let me tell you something. If you get full of Jesus, if you ever get full of Jesus, Jesus is going to come out of you. And when you get full of Jesus and he starts coming out of you, some people are going to think you're crazy. Now, some of them already think you're crazy, but that's for other reasons. But if you get full of Jesus and you go home to somebody who's not full of Jesus, they're going to think you're crazy. You get full of Jesus, you're going to be a fanatic. Oh, you're a fanatic. You just pray in front of some people, you're a fanatic. You talk about church in front of some people, you're a fanatic. Well, just sign me up. I'm going to a big house, but it's in heaven. Not one on earth, hopefully. There's a lot of people that think you're insane, but it's not sane. Matter of fact, what Paul tells them, he says, listen, I want you to understand something. It's not insanity. It's love. It's love. It's love that's compelling us. Paul talks about this love of Christ. I want to share two major things about this love of Christ with you. One, Paul says, I want you to know it's an indwelling love. It's an indwelling love. When he speaks of the love of Christ, there it means it's something that's living in him. Now, there's several things that, several ways this love of Christ is understood or approached. And I believe what I'm going to tell you three ways that people look at this text, Bible scholars, pastors, whatever. And I believe that all three of these apply to what Paul's talking about. But I believe there's one that's going to be the overriding principle that he's talking about here. But I want to talk to you about all three of them so we get a full grasp of this little phrase, the love of Christ. So the first thing is, Paul is talking about Christ's love for us. Christ's love for us. What greater love could anyone know than to know the love of God? To know God's love. Nothing is greater than to know. Not to say, well, smile, God loves you. God loves everybody. We say those things so flippantly and so meaningless. Listen, but I want to tell you, what Paul's talking about is a love that's filled your heart from the head of the top of your head to the soles of your feet. And all within, God's love has overwhelmed you. God's love has overpowered you. God's love has filled you. You know that it's real. Nobody can tell you. It's not a theory. It's not a sermon. It's God. God pouring out his love on you. And he says, I've had this love in me. It's the love of Jesus. What greater love has this? No man known than the love of God, to have the love of God poured out in your life. It motivates us to serve God, to please God, to obey God. People who are not motivated by the love of God may have never experienced the love of God. Love, the love of God pours out on us. It's amazing love. We sing about it. Amazing love. Great love. No greater love. When God's love fills your heart and your soul, it will change you. It becomes more than a theory, more than a song, and all those songs are great, but if they never move past a song, they never touch us. A lot of people in church, I'm afraid, haven't experienced the love of God in a long, long time. Haven't experienced the love of God in a long, long, long time. Have you? Have you been alone with God and experienced the love of God? Secondly, that love of Christ, that Christ's love for us, causes something else. It causes our love for Christ. Christ's love for us will produce our love for him. This flows, our love for him flows from his love for us. No one can truly love God until they have experienced the love of God. I want to tell you, people who don't love God have never experienced the love of God. And if you've ever experienced the love of God, where he rescued you, where he changed you, when he lets you know that he loves you despite of who you are and all you haven't done and all you have done, when that kind of love comes in, you're going to love him. You're going to want to love him. You're going to be empowered to love him. Nobody's got to tell you to love him. Listen, there ain't nobody got to tell me to love God. Nobody's got to get up and tell me in the morning, go love God, because God lives in me and he loves me, and nobody has to tell me. Nobody has to remind me to come to church. Nobody has to ever call me to come to church. Nobody's ever had to call me to come to worship. Why? Because God lives in me and God loves me, and I've been changed by the love of God. I might start preaching here in a few minutes, so y'all just hold on. Listen, no one can truly love God. We wonder, why don't these people love God? Because they don't know the love of God. That's why. And you can gather in church. You ever been to church and it'd be dead? A bunch of people who hadn't experienced the love of God lately. Because when you experience it, you're going to offer it back up. Romans 5:5 says this, now hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. The Holy Spirit will pour out God's love upon you and in you when he comes to you. When you get the Holy Spirit, there's going to be a love for God that's going to automatically come. It's just going to be, there's going to be a love for God. You're going to want to worship Him. You're going to want to praise Him. 1 John 4:19, we love Him because He first loved us. It's just that simple. We love Him. Not because mama raised me to, that's good. Not because the preacher said I ought to, that's good. It's because He first loved us and we know it. And we've experienced it. And we've been changed by it. So Christ's love for us, then our love for Christ. And then thirdly, Christ's love in us. There's something about Christ's love in us and through us. See, we believe that when we are saved, Jesus comes to live in us through the Holy Spirit. Do you believe that? That's Bible doctrine. The Bible teaches that when you get saved, God's going to come live within you in the person of the Holy Spirit. Now, it only stands to reason then, God's going to come to live in me. This is Christ's love in me, in us and through us. So, if the Holy Spirit lives in me, and guess what? The Holy Spirit loves unsaved people. You know the Holy Spirit loves unsaved people? God the Father loves unsaved people. Listen, the Bible says, Romans 5:8, but God demonstrates His own love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. While we were still a long way from God, while I was still blaspheming God, Jesus died for me. God loved me. While I was a long way from God, God loves sinners. God loves unsaved sinners. God loved me as an unsaved sinner. The Holy Spirit loved me as an unsaved sinner. And we know Jesus loved us as unsaved sinners. Paul writes in Galatians 2:20, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me. So, God the Father loves unsaved people. God the Son loves unsaved people. God the Holy Spirit loves unsaved people. And I say I'm saved. And I say God lives in me. It would stand to reason that I would love unsaved people. It would just stand to reason. Hey, listen, I'm not the sharpest knife in the drawer. And nobody amen that either. Some of you, that's the only thing I'll say all day, that you'll amen if I don't stop you. But listen, when God lives in us and He loves other people and He loves unsaved people, it just only stands to reason I'll start to love them. See, you begin to love their souls. You love them like God loves them. There's a lot of people, you know, that want to see people suffer. I don't want to see people suffer. I watch the news sometimes and my heart goes out for those people. We've made donations to these, you know, GoFundMe this and go pay for that thing. And just watching the news. Somebody, I just feel for them. But I'm going to tell you something. I love their souls because He loves their souls and He lives in me. I'm concerned if they're going to hell or not. You know what? When I was unsaved, I used to tell people to go to hell. I used to say so-and-so can go to hell. Now, I'm praying they don't go there. I'm trying to find a way to tell them how not to go there. What is that? That's the love of God. That's how God loves people. Many people claim to be Christians, claim to have Jesus in their heart, and they wouldn't give an unsaved person the time of day, much less the gospel. And I want to tell you today, if you're here and somebody's been talking to you and urging you to come and urging you to believe and trying to talk to you about getting saved, that's the love of God through them to you. That's the love of God through them to you. God's loving your soul through them. God wants your soul in heaven. God wants your soul to be saved, and He is loving you through them. That's the love of Christ that's compelling them to tell you. So it's an indwelling love. It's in us and it's got to come out. But the second thing about this love, it's a compelling love. It's indwelling, but it's compelling. Look again at verse 14. For the love of Christ compels us. That word can be translated controls or constrains. I think the King James says constraineth us. The word means pressure that produces action or reaction. Pressure that produces action or reaction. So you can think about anything that happens. You take a tube of toothpaste. You open that cap, you put a little pressure, toothpaste is coming out. You keep that cap closed, by the way, and you put enough pressure, toothpaste is coming out. It's a pressure that causes something to happen. See, this is what the love of God is. It's an internal pressure. is an internal power that's moving in us. And it causes a couple of things. One, it compels us to act. It compels us to act. Think about this. Jesus acted because of the love of God, didn't he? You know, can you think of anybody who had it any better than Jesus in heaven? Jesus had it good. You think you got it good? Jesus was in heaven. They was all worshiping. He was the Son of God. He was on the throne of God with the Father. Man, he had never sinned. He had never personally encountered sin on earth. And then he took on flesh. And he dwelt among us. And he walked among people who hated him, who crucified him, who spit on him, who beat him, who killed him, who pulled his beard out. He was buried in a barred tomb. He hung on a cross. And he rose again. The love of God compelled him to act. One day he went back to heaven, but he said, "Don't wait, don't worry, boys, I'm coming back." And the love of God's going to compel him to come back to this earth one day. The love of God compelled him to leave the glories of heaven so he could come and be our Redeemer and our Savior and our substitute to die on the cross for our sins. So that very love that compelled him to leave heaven and compel the apostles to go into all the earth and the church from then on to take the gospel to others must compel us to act. It must compel us to invite someone, to talk to someone, to build a relational bridge with someone that I can share the love of Christ. It must compel me to call someone, to give someone a tract, to share my testimony, to give someone more than the time of day, but to give them a genuine heart that cares for them. It must compel us or it doesn't live within us. Many Christians and many churches, to be honest with you, are do-nothings. Do nothing for the Lord. Busy with worldly things, worldly endeavors, no time, no energy, no desire for the things of God, no concern for the souls of men. But the love of God will compel us. Souls are perishing. Men are dying. I was just reading that song in my hymnal this morning. Rescue the perishing. Care for the dying. Jesus is merciful. Jesus will save. That's the Jesus that you and I are following. That's the Jesus that we say lives in us. You know, unsaved people are motivated to do things. They're motivated to end poverty, fight poverty. And I agree, we need to help fight that. They're motivated to fix the global water crisis, and Christians ought to be involved in that. Some of them are motivated to fix climate change, and they'll fly in their jets all over the world to do it. But listen, souls are perishing, and the only people who will ever be motivated to change that are the saved. And if we're not motivated, God help our community. God help the people that live around this community. A bunch of churches aren't motivated to reach them. God help the people in this community. A bunch of people who fill these seats aren't motivated to bring others in to hear the gospel. If you fix the water crisis and they go to hell, it doesn't matter in the end. It compels us to act. Number two, it compels us to live for Christ. It compels us. We're talking about priority and purpose for the gospel. That love of Christ compels us to live our lives for him. Now notice what happens in verse 14 and 15. This is very important. It's a very important theological truth that we need to see this morning. Verse 14, again, look what he says. For the love of Christ compels us because we judge thus. We understand this, Paul says, that if one died for all, who was that? That's Jesus. One died for all. This is known as the substitutionary atonement of Jesus. The word for there, one died for all, can be translated on behalf of or in the place of. It speaks of the fact that Jesus took my sin's punishment on the cross. People understand, well, why did Jesus have to die if God's loving? Because God's holy. And sin must be punished. Every sin's going to be punished. Every sin. You mean God doesn't just overlook them? No. No, listen. God's never overlooked one sin. Not one lie. Not one cuss word, not one bad thought. And those things are either put on Christ or they're put on the sinner who has committed them. One died for all in the place of all. So that's Jesus. But he goes on, now he's going to move and say, then all died. Now what does he mean? See, he's not saying all were dead. We just read this text in Ephesians 2. Philip read it. You were dead in trespasses and sins. The Bible teaches that when you and I were unsaved, we didn't have a spiritual heart for God. We were dead, spiritually dead. Can you ever remember when you had no motivation for God in any way? Can you remember that you never even thought about God in any way? I used his name as a cuss word. I certainly never thought about it. I was dead in trespasses and sins. That's the condition of all people who are unsaved. They do not have a living relationship with Jesus. But Paul's not talking about that. He's talking about not a condition, which is dead, but an event. Look at it. Again, one that if one died for all, then all died. What is he talking about? He's talking about all believers who died to their sin and self when they repented and believed the gospel. So I want to tell you this morning, to be saved, salvation is a death to life experience. You die to your sin and yourself, and you get to live with Jesus now and forever. And if you've never died, then you've never lived. Galatians 2:20, Paul says it this way, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. That's a death experience. Paul said, I died. I died to myself. I died to my sin. And now I'm living for God. I've got God living in me. I live by faith in the Son of God. So Paul, he's explaining that when we repent, we no longer live for ourselves. We no longer trust in our human goodness. See, some people think, well, only bad people need to get saved. There's a lot of good people that need to get saved. There are going to be a lot of people who don't get to heaven because they thought they were too bad. There are going to be a lot of people who don't get to heaven because they thought they were too good. I'm going to tell you, you got to die to all of it. Your goodness and your badness. Your self-righteousness and your sinfulness. You have to die to all of it. And when you do, you get to live with Jesus. This passage teaches us that the love of Christ is a sacrificial love, caused him to give up his life. But that same love will cause us to give up our lives. It'll cause us to give up our sin, ourself. We don't have to live for ourselves anymore. We don't have to trust ourselves anymore, our goodness. And I want to go as far as say this. If you're here today and you're unsaved, I want to tell you something. You are the reason you don't believe. And the person that has to die for you to believe is you. Somebody said, well, I went to a church. They got problems. But that ain't the reason you're not going to go to heaven. You've got to die to your sin and self. The reason you don't follow Jesus is not because your pastor or not because of the church or not because this happened. The reason you don't follow Jesus is because you haven't died to your sin and self. You're the person that has to die because you're the person that wants to live. Unsaved people are going to go to hell because of themselves. Christians are going to live their lives selfishly and not compelled by the love of God because of themselves and no one else. You have to die to your sin, yourself, your trust in who you are, and you have to live for Jesus. And you can have life. Hallelujah. You came today to hear your own funeral. I'm preaching your own funeral this morning. So join in the casket. Get the casket march. Let's get the pallbearers. Let's get a bunch of dead folks. And then we can all get up on Resurrection Sunday. Today can be your Resurrection Sunday. Hallelujah. We got more to talk about, but that was pretty good, wasn't it? Let's move on. Next, the last thing I want you to see, it compels us to live for Christ, but it also compels us to see others differently. It compels us to see others differently. Look at verse 16. Now, I've died to myself. I've rose again with Jesus. I'm alive. Now, look what happens. Verse 16. Therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh. Even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him thus no longer. What's he talking about? We regard no one according to the flesh means we do not see people any longer through a worldly, human perspective. See, what Paul is going to tell us here is, I see people differently because I see Jesus differently. You notice he says, I knew Christ according to the flesh. So just think about his story. When he was Saul of Tarsus, he knew Jesus according to the flesh and he hated him. You know some people that blaspheme God? They say they know God. No, they know him according to the flesh. I knew him according to the flesh, and I blasphemed him. Paul said, I knew him according to the flesh, and I was persecuting him. The Bible says he persecuted Jesus. Jesus, when he appeared to him, said, Paul, why are you persecuting me? So Paul said, I knew him according to the flesh, and I hated him. And I wanted to stomp him out. I wanted to stomp his people out. But now, as the Apostle Paul, he loved him, and he served him, and he wanted to tell people about him. Why? Because now he knew him according to the Spirit and truth. See, some of us know Jesus according to the flesh, but we don't know him according to the Spirit and truth. But when you know him according to the Spirit and truth, you just love him, and you want to serve him, and you know that other people need to hear about him. So when I knew God according to the flesh, I blasphemed him. I took his name in vain. But now, what a difference it makes to know him according to the Spirit. Here recently, my wife has really enjoyed telling people about the time when I was unsaved. She's told this story twice recently. And we went to church. And we left church, and I told her, I'll never go back to church. My wife's just got a lot of laughs out of that lately. She's just really enjoyed it. It's true. I just can't wait to get here. Listen, that's what happens when you know Jesus according to the Spirit as according to the flesh. And listen, many people around you in this community know Jesus according to the flesh. You can talk to them. You know Jesus. Yeah, I have a good relationship with God. They blaspheme him all day long, but then they have a good relationship with him. What is that? They know him according to the flesh. They have a head knowledge. They believe facts, but their heart has never been transformed by the love of God. They've never been changed. They've never been born again. They have never died so they can live. They have a head knowledge of God. They would not tell you that there is no God, but they do not know him. They've never been transformed by the love of God. So, this love compels us to see these people differently, though. Notice we have two things. We have a new perspective of people. Paul says this means we don't see them regarding to the flesh. We don't see them with just a human perspective any longer. So listen to this. This means we don't look at their race. Now we see their race. We know they're Caucasian or Asian or African American or blah, 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 whatever the race they are. It's not that it's not important, but it's not most important. Let me tell you something. If that's most important to you, you just see people according to their flesh. We don't see them according to their gender, male or female, which is the only two, and they are continual and steady. They don't change. We don't see them according to their sexuality. We don't look at them, well, we know they might be homosexual. We know that, but that's not how we see them. We don't see them according to their social standing. They may be a big shot. They may have no shot. What does that matter? We don't see them according to their economic or their educational standing. Here's a big one. We don't see them according to their politics. Race and politics and sexuality and gender, it's tearing our country all apart. You want to know why? Because everybody sees everybody according to the flesh. I want to ask, where are the Christians that are going to see people according to the Spirit? We don't see them according to their ideology. Now listen, I want to be honest with you. Some of these things that we're talking about, politics, ideology, they may be repulsive to us. And in some regards, we have to stand against the politics and the agenda that they're pushing on our nation. We have to, because we still have a right to, and we must. But beyond all of that, we have to see that person as a soul whom Jesus died for and whom Jesus loves. And I may vote against you and I may oppose you politically. I may oppose you ideology and all that. But cut that out of the tape. That's bloopers. Hey, listen. But your soul is more important than politics or your race or your gender, or all of this. The fact that we strongly disagree about certain things does not matter, because beyond that is a soul whom Jesus loved and Jesus died for. Harry Ironside, he was a preacher years ago. He sounds like a gunfighter. I love those guys. I picture him like carrying a Bible and a pistol around his waist, you know, like my kind of preacher. But anyway, Harry Ironside said this about this text. Listen to this. When we are of the world, he's assuming that we're not of the world anymore. When you get saved, you're not of the world anymore. When we were of the world, we made much of the flesh and all that was linked with it. We thought of men as great or rich or as powerful, talented or able, or as superior one to another. Some men were despised because they were poor and ignorant and degraded with little intelligence and less talented. But now all that has changed. Now we know no man after the flesh. We look out now upon this world, not thinking of the different distinctions between man and man, but as seeing a world of sinners for whom Christ died. And we realize that all men, whether rich or poor, foolish or wise, whether barbarian or civilized, whether morons or highly talented, are all dear to the heart of God, for God so loved the world. That's how we've got to look at these people around us. Wherever we encounter them, wherever place they are in life, we have to have a new perspective upon them. They are souls that Jesus died for. And it doesn't matter what they've done and how different they are from us. We're never going to reach them if we keep judging them through those lenses. But I got more. Y'all want more? I got more. Let's go. Last but not least, we have a new hope for people. Because the love of God lives in us, we have a new hope for people. Can anybody here be honest? Some people make me hopeless. Some people we feel hopeless for. Look at verse 17. We're not through. We got more Bible to look at. Therefore, because I don't see anyone according to the flesh anymore, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. When I got saved, I used to read that verse. When I started preaching, I used to quote that verse almost every time I preached. I felt like it was my life story. Sometimes I'd read that verse and I'd just cry. See, we have a hope for people. We believe Paul is here is saying to them, God made a change in me. I hated Jesus and I hated everybody that loved Jesus. And now I love Jesus and I love everybody that hates Jesus. He was a new creation. All of that stuff had passed away and God had made him new. And he says this basically, I believe that if God can make me new, God can make them new. If God can change me, God can change anyone. I want to tell you this morning, God used a man, Paul, who hated the church and tried to stomp it out to be the greatest planter of the church in history. A man who wrote most of the New Testament and the leading apostle of his day and age. When we are saved, we are God's love creation in Christ, any man in Christ. And I want to tell you this morning, I don't care who that person is, they can be changed. There is hope for them. They may be the hard-hearted person this morning, but you just begin to pray that God will give them a new heart. They may be a long way from God. You may say, they'll never come, man. They hate God. They're a blasphemer. God can change them. You may say, listen, they're trapped in homosexuality. God can change them. They may be trapped in adultery. God can change them. They may be an alcoholic. God can change them. God can make them new. We have to have a hope for them. They may not have any hope for themselves, but we've got to believe that our God is still able, and any man in Christ can be brand new. All that old stuff can pass away. There's new life that can come in Jesus. You die to yourself and God will raise you anew, a fresh, new, living believer in Jesus. He can give you eternal life, hope, and victory. This morning, folks, listen, we've got to have that hope. We've got to believe that these people can be saved, that God wants them to be saved, and he can change them. And this is why we live sent. We live sent to care and to share and to bless because these people can be changed. You may have somebody that one time said they love God and they're a long way from God. God can change them. Some of you sitting here today would say that's your testimony. You got a long way from God and God brought you back. Some of you today have never been saved. And I love you in Jesus' name, but you're the reason you're not saved. And you have to repent and believe. You have to die to yourself that you might live to Jesus. How do you do that? You have to repent. Acknowledge to God that you're a sinner. Acts 3:19 says, repent therefore and be converted that your sins may be blotted out, so that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. God will renew you, refresh you, give you a living hope in Christ. Repent. When you repent, the Bible says if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And I stand on that in the authority of the word of God. Thus says the Lord, whosoever believes. Are you one of those who's died to yourself and lived to Christ?